after the, well, relatively an unsuccessful Hot Space album, there was a little bit of dissatisfaction there, and we toured, and we didn't have to enjoy it so much, and we decided to take a long time off, you know, and it was quite a long time before we actually went into the studio, which gave us all a chance to get a break from each other, and you know, for people to try other things as well. And it has resulted in, you know, like Brian doing some solo work, Roger doing another album, Freddie starting an album. And in the end, I think it was good for us as well. And now we're back together. I think we're more committed as a group. I'd sit alone and watch your light. My only friend through teenage night. Is everything I had to know? I heard it on my radio. Every album that's ever come out of Queen, we come up with a batch of songs, and we really pick best. And if I have songs that I feel are better than somebody else's, if I have five songs that are better than one of Roger's songs, I'll say we won't have his one song. Like, I remember that Roger actually wrote about three or four songs, and as far as I was concerned, some of them weren't good enough, and I just said, go back and write some more, and things like that. So, I mean, but, you know, then Roger will come up with something like Radio Gaga, and it's perfect.
My two-year-old son was listening to the radio, and I thought it was all, he just said, oh, Radio Kaka or something. And I had to agree. And in fact, we never changed the lyric. All we hear is Radio Kaka, Radio Gugu, Radio Gaga. All we hear is Radio Kaka, Radio Gaga, Radio was new.
Synthesizers changed and we changed, that's all I can say. And in the beginning, synthesizers were very mechanical and you could put no emotion into them. But having seen people like Stevie Wonder who can make the synthesizer talk the same as you can with a voice or a guitar, then you became converted. We don't totally go over to synthesizers, but the synthesizers are there for certain things. And it's fun to use those things too. And a lot of the new album, The Works, is a synthesis of the two kinds, and almost a battle between the two kinds, a battle between the machines and the humans.
Because it used to be, you just used to make the record, but now you've got to make a mini film as well. Mm-hmm. And often it's more expensive. Sometimes you don't really, you know, a record doesn't always suit the visual medium.
Do you think it deprives the listener of some sense of imagination?
It can do in a way. That was something that Radio Gaga was about in a way. You used to just put your mind, you used to make your own pictures in your mind when you listen to something. But now, if there's the video, that you immediately think of that those visual ideas that have already been thought of by somebody else.
It's a very important aspect of a group, really. I mean, their appearance as well as the music they play. And also, I mean, it's just we've all changed our looks as well over the years. So, I don't know. It's something I don't tend to get involved in as much as the rest of the others, because we all have our different areas of things we get involved in.
But do you still get along with the love that Freddie seems to have of drag queens and transvestite and all that that gets through in the videos?
Oh, yes. Yeah, well, that was even on Want to Break Free, which was my song. I mean, I was very willing to go along. I think Roger had the idea at first, and it worked very well. So it's entertaining. I think it's very good, and we all had a lot of fun doing that one as well.
I've dined to dress up in drag, doesn't everybody? But it was just one of those things. In fact, it wasn't my idea at all. I'm sure everybody thinks it's my idea being outrageous.
It was Roger's, wasn't it?
It was. I mean, it came from Roger, and I was, and everybody thinks, I bet. In fact, they asked me, so how did you get the other three to get into it? In fact, they ran into their frocks quicker than anything. And I said, no, wait a minute, I was still wearing my high heels. And it was just one of those things. It was their idea, basically, and I said, yeah, let's have a go. And in fact, sometimes it's something that would have been so obvious for me to do, but because it was their idea, it was sort of, it came across that much better. I think if it was me that actually started, it would have been very hard for them to accept the role, and I don't think it would have come across.
But life still goes on. I can't get used to living without, living without, living without you by my side. I don't want to live alone.
Fred, it's true that the song I Want to Break Free is dedicated for the gay world.
No, not at all, not at all. That song, to start off with, that song was written by John Deacon, you know, and, well, he's a very happily married man, you know, with about four children. I don't think where you got that message from. It's got nothing to do with gay people at all. It's basically about everybody. It's just somebody who has a very tough life, and he just wants to break free from whatever problems he's got. It's got nothing to do with the gay thing. Besides, it's not my song anyway. John wrote it.
É verdade que a música I Want to Break Free é dedicada ao mundo gay.
And I told you about that. See, I'm helping you out. Next question.
Has been the leader of the band. It's
difficult. I'm not the leader of the band, by the way.
No.
Yeah, everybody calls me the leader of the band. I'm just the lead singer.
Okay,
and no, there's no such thing. But I'm not the general or anything. We're all four equal people, four members, and they seem to call me the leader of the band, but I'm just the lead vocalist.
Difícil, né, ser líder do Queen? Quer dizer, você tem problemas de relacionamento com os quatro por ser o líder do grupo?
This time, I am the leader of the group, yes.
My best song.
Questions up. Basically, I mean, in terms of video now, I like to have fun in them, because I think if you do that, it comes across, and then, you know, people can relate to that. And basically, it's just me having fun. And so I can't, you know, I can't just sit in a chair and knit a blouse or whatever. I mean, it's just I've got to go through all these horrible sort of scenes and things, which is what I'm all about. So, you know, they're just, in a funny way, they're just parts of my life, so I'm just putting them in pictures.
Yeah, I felt silly and you know, it was you know, weird things to do, really. But I don't know, I think it really with everybody making videos, I mean, you have to try something different as well. And Freddie had some strong ideas, and in the absence of any other really good ideas, then you know, you go with it, really. And some of them work very well.
I think it's our style, you know. If we do something, then we do it to excess, and we do it as hard as we can do it. And yeah, it's very overblown, it's very over the top, but it's fun and we like it. That's the way we are.
I look back on myself and say, I did it for love. Yes, I did it for love.
I'm a true romantic, yeah, just like Rudolph Valentino. Now, I like writing romantic songs. I've always written those, I mean, since the early days, since the first, second album. And I think I'll always write them, because, I mean, they're sort of part of me, and that doesn't mean I only write those kind of songs. I like to write all kinds of different songs, but the romantic types will always be there.
Music is something different from anything else. It's not just people sitting playing and everyone closes their eyes, you know. Rock music is the complete contact.
We're aware of the current trends and changes, and we write accordingly. I mean, Brian still, you know, writes in a heavy mold or whatever, and I think between the four of us, I mean, we write very different songs, which is very good.
Fade to fade, like the lane.
Because you have the opportunity to do whatever you want on that stage, you know, and we have the best people, the best technicians, and we say, we want this to happen here and this to happen there, and they say, okay, we find a way, you know, and the people who built this rig are just so very clever, you know, they make all this stuff, the lights and the special effects have never been seen before, everything is built special, nothing that people buy, and so they built the rig, which is like a kind of like a bird, I think, you know, that can move its wings.
That working is a really important thing in your life. You can't just sit on this and do nothing. It's the worst thing possible.
Give it to me one more time!
Vom Gesicht meistens heute.
Okay. How does it feel at the end of a day like that? Do you like your job? In an evening like that?
I love my job, but I hate talking to people like you.
Thanks.
No, do you mean? I love it right now because I said earlier on, you're the last person I'm talking to, so you probably get the best interview, darling, don't worry.
I mean, the whole thing like this afternoon when you have to talk to so many journalists, what goes on?
Well, it's part of my job, so I have to do it. We don't do it that often, so I mean, it's like this is the first kind of press conference we've had for a long while, you know, 3, 4, 5 years maybe. So, I don't mind it. If I had to do this every day, forget it.
Do you sometimes have the feeling that, I mean, obviously people are asking the same questions all the time, that it's
they always
your
do.
Music is your statement
always
and
do.
Not the talking?
No. I think it's more than music, you know. We're personality, so you talk about more than music. I mean, if all you talked about was music, depending on if you're a music paper, then you talk about music. But there's more to us than just writing songs. I mean, we do other things and we have characters and depends what you talk about. So I don't mind it. No. And of course people ask the same questions because some of the questions are current and they want to know about the same things. So ask me about my solo album then, huh?
Yeah, what about your solo album?
Oh, it's great.
Of course it is. Does it sound very different?
Yes, it sounds.
I heard you had a break.
Hopefully it's not finished yet, see, so I don't know how it's going to come out. But at the moment, I've worked on it for about 2 months, 2 or 3 months, and I was supposed to finish it before the Queen tour, but I needed a bit more time. And it's sounding good. It's nice to actually play with different people, because I've always played with Queen all the time, and so I had a drummer from. The session drummer from Munich and a guitarist from Munich, so basically all German players, and it's made my song sound different, you know.
To people outside, it sometimes feels funny that or special that there are so many solo projects, whereas the band is still going as well on the side. How would you analyze the influence of the solo stuff? For the band when you come back together again? Is that an advantage that you're four strong writers who also do stuff on your own, or does it...
Yes, I think in a funny way, I thought because I think this is one of the few groups that all four members write, and I thought that we'd be doing solo albums much before this. But I think in a funny way, when we do a Queen album, they're like four solo projects within themselves anyway, because I mean, I have my bunch of songs, Brian has his, and Roger and John, and so it's like four little solo projects working side by side, and then we put them all together. So I think that was the reason that we didn't actually go and do solo projects earlier on. I mean, if we were writing all the same kind of songs, then we would have gotten fed up and said, oh, I want to do my solo album first. But we're all writing different songs, so it keeps us interested. So for what, about 13 years or whatever, you know, that was interesting enough for us to carry on. And as far as I was concerned, all Queen albums were little solo projects anyway. I was writing my kind of songs that I wanted. But now I think the time has come where I want a whole album of my own, and Roger's done two already, so I think most people thought that I would be the first one to have a solo album, and then the band, you know, Queen would break up and all that, but here you are, after 13 years, four old ladies are still rocking away.
What about the actual work in the studio when you four come together and everybody wants to bring his side of songs?
Yeah, that happens all the time, yeah.
It sounds like having also...
It's like a cockfight, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, four cocks fighting. God, it's getting nice, this. Yeah, but you know, the funny thing is, this sort of happened almost when we met, the four of us. And it's just, you won't believe it. I mean, people think that, okay, now they're fighting. We fought on virtually the first day, because we used to know each other from university and all that. And we used to fight about musical ideas and this and that, because we're all very strong characters, you know, and we all have egos and all that, so we always kept fighting. But I think the fighting seems to keep us together, because I think sometimes I think bands break up when there's one very strong person and the others and the others get left out, and they think, oh god, this asshole's just too strong and we want to join another band. But the four of us are real, actually I can't say these four letter words, huh? We're very strong, you know, individually, so we just keep going at each other. And I think the reason we've stayed together for so long is just none of us want to leave, because I mean, if you leave, it's like being a coward and you're going out. So we still keep going, and as long as the music is still there, and as long as the people are still buying the music, then it's okay. When they stop buying our records, then I'll say goodbye and do something else, become a strip artist or something.
Yeah, what music you would strip? What music would you use?
All the songs I've written. Like, come on.
Announcing a tour like that, if you think of the tour life that's ahead of you, is that a pleasant imagination, or do you hate tour life, basically?
What, the touring?
Touring and all this.
It depends. I mean, this tour I'm looking forward to, because we haven't done it for 2 years. There was a time where we were doing tours so extensively, because I mean, we would go into a studio, make an album, and then tour the world, and then we'd go back, and that was the routine. I mean, I didn't have any time to actually break away. And we virtually did that for about 8 or 9 years, and that's why the last couple of years we wanted to break away from that format, because I was getting very bored and so were the others, and just to get away and do different things and think about certain things. And so this tour I'm looking forward to, because we haven't toured, and we can do different things. It's going to be it's going to be fresh, you know. And otherwise there were tours I hated, because I mean, we used to do American tours that lasted for 3 or 4 months, and towards the end it was just terrible. I just never wanted to go on a stage again, because after a while the songs sounded very, you know, if you're doing it for 3 months, you have to say routine. Do the same routine, and you know, you need time away so you can get freshness into it. And I think that probably happens to everybody.
What's the fresh element now in the new tour that
you're doing? My costume. No, it's just it's new. I mean, the one thing element that I like on this tour is that we are actually going to go all the way back and do songs from all the old albums as well, because so that I think anybody coming to see Queen this time is going to get a little piece of all the albums. So I mean, there are times where somebody comes to a show and say, oh, they didn't do anything from this album or whatever. Of course we can't do all the songs from 13 albums, it would be there for 2 days. But I think what we're doing is we're going to take, even if it's one song from one album or two from each, we're not going to leave any album out. So I think that that to me is fun, because we've been practicing some of the early stuff. I mean, we're practicing Keep Yourself Alive and Liars from the first album. And it made me think, you know, that about 13 years ago we were doing this, and at that time I had long hair and black fingernails and makeup and everything, the kind of thing that Boy George is doing right now. And to think that I'd sort of still be singing those songs, it sort of makes me sound old, doesn't it?
Well,
I don't look too bad for 37, I tell you.
Do you have the feeling that a lot of people are imitating, because you mentioned Boy George, do you have the feeling that you see them come and go while your career is going on, you know, so many new bands?
I don't think Boy George is going to come and go. I think Boy George is going to be here for a long while. They always have, I mean, there's always people that come up like that, and you, for me, you can always tell somebody who's going to stay, and Boy George is going to stay. Mm. I don't know. What do you think?
Yes, I think so too. The question is, what will he wear in 10 years?
Oh, that doesn't matter. I mean, you know, that's the least of his problems, I should think, you know. No.
What does it mean to you? I mean, I talked to Keith Richards recently, and he said the most important thing in his career was when he realized that being on stage and being admired by young kids is not the answer to life. Did you have a similar experience once when you first of all thought that's it, and then you, from a certain stage, you're thinking of something else?
No, the most important thing to me is to be happy, to be honest, to have fun. And depending on how, whatever I do, I mean, of course, music is important to me, and because that's my life. And as long as, I mean, I can, I'll carry on as long as I write music and people want to buy it. That's important to me, but I mean, that's not the be-all and the end-all. I mean, I just, they're very, to me, happiness is the most important thing. And if I'm happy, then it shows in my work. And so basically, I just want to be happy and make a lot of money and buy a lot of things, especially in Vienna.
Yeah, antique. Yep, just a moment. You were also recording something with Michael Jackson that was not released yet. I think the song is even called Victory. Is that true?
That's right. Yeah. I've done like three tracks with him, and that was about a year ago, longer than that. And yes, Victory was one of the songs, but he wanted to use the title for the Jackson thing. But the song is still there, and it's probably just waiting until the two of us get together and finish it.
You haven't finished
it yet? No, I mean, it's just because he has commitments, I have commitments, and it's very difficult. I mean, he's on tour, I'm going on tour, and you've got to sort of, you know, it's very, very difficult when two different, you know, musicians are trying to get together. I mean, he has to do his stuff, and it's just that when I was spending some time in L.A. and we're friends, he said, oh, why don't we try something? So, I mean, one day it'll probably be finished, and... Well, the other song is called State of Shock, which I did, and Mick Jagger's on it, but it's all okay, because Michael called me up and said, look, I want to finish a song, I want it on the Jackson's album, and I said, I can't come over, because I'm in Munich, and he said, well, is it okay if Mick does it? So I said, fine, you know, songs are songs, I mean, as long as our friendship carries on, we can write all kinds of songs after that.
With what other people could you think of cooperating, like you do with Bowie and Jackson on this unreleased stuff? What are people who are interested?
It depends. I mean, I just I don't sort of think of those things. I mean, sometimes you just meet friends, and if you think about doing a song together, you talk about that. Otherwise, that's not what I think about all the time. I mean, they're. Elton and I have been friends for a long time, but we've actually sort of said to each other, one day we probably go in there together and write a song. But it's better being friends, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And the thing about it is it's spontaneity. So I mean, it's just if it happens that we're talking, and suddenly we say, oh, let's go in the studio and do it. That's the best thing, and that's what happened with David Bowie. He was just around. We were having dinner for a couple of days, and we were recording. In a studio, and he just said, oh, maybe I'll come in and just see what happens. So it wasn't planned. If it's planned, then it's boring, because then it just... And we were just going in there and fooling around to see what happened, and suddenly this song started taking shape, and we said, oh, that's quite nice, let's work on it a bit. And the result of that was Under Pressure. So I'm not really... I don't get up every morning and say, okay, who am I going to work with today? Those kind of things don't work.
How would you describe yourself as an artist? Would you say that you're a very organized person, very spontaneous person, or how would you say?
No, myself as an artist, I'm just a musical prostitute, my dear. Just just basically that.
Organized or not?
Well, who cares? Disorganized and organized. That's an asshole question to ask anybody. It's just, I don't know, I'm just me, you know, I'm just me. I'm very disorganized at times, I'm organized at times, and I'm just me.
What emotions do you have when you see old stuff, for example, like you mentioned before, with long hair and black fingernails?
Oh, when I see myself. Oh dear, I want to tear them all up. I just think, I actually laugh at myself. But I know that it was something that you have to do. I think someone like Boy George, in about 5 or 10 years' time, is going to look and say, oh my God, did I really look like that? But he knows that it was relevant at the time, and it was right, and I think I don't regret any of the things I did. It's just that I laugh. I mean, what did you look like 10 years ago?
Horrible, yeah.
Do you look at your pictures? And
yes.
Oh, there you are, then.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I just think, and it's a process of growing up, you know, to experience, and I just think, at this point in time, I think if I had long hair and fingernails and wearing the things, I would look ridiculous. I mean, I looked ridiculous then, but it worked. But it was all right then, so it's just growing up and gaining experience.
If you look at all members of the band, I know it's a difficult question, but what do you think every single member does contribute to the special chemistry that's Queen in the end?
It's hard to sort of pinpoint those things, because I mean, we certainly have it's an ingredient between the four of us, otherwise it wouldn't have worked, especially for this long. And we all have a role to play, but I couldn't tell you what it was. I mean, it's just, the only thing I could tell you is the reason is because we are diverse. We're four different characters coming from, and that's why I think it's worked. Not two of us are the same. I mean, so that, you know, we all like totally different things, but we come together. It's a chemistry that works. And I couldn't tell you what it was, because, I mean, who can? It's just something that seems to fit. And that's what good bands are made of, you know? And we're good.
Okay, thank you very much.
That's the line, yeah, that was perfect.
What was it about the Montreux Festival that encouraged you to come here?
Well, it's a long story, really, but we almost did it as a last-minute thing because we didn't quite realise the import of where it was. Montreux is almost home for us, strangely enough, because we have the studios here, and we often come here. But at the last moment, we just thought, my God, this is a show which is really getting to more people than we can get to in about 3 or 4 gigs, you know. It's what, 400 million people, you know, so I mean...
It takes 300 tours, I think, yeah. That's when you get to that number.
When was the last time that you appeared on stage together?
Shocking, 2 years ago or so. It's all driving us mad, very fidgety.
In the baseball stadium in Tokyo.
So will Montreux go down in sort of Queen history as encouraging you to get back on the road again?
It's very strange, because one of the reasons to do this, and the other one was to actually get together and talk about what we should do in the future. It's a sort of demarcation line for us. And we've been together a long time, and we feel like we need to organise our future goals. It sounds really pretentious and very unfair. What it means is, we've had our break, and we want to get back to it, and we want to discover exactly how to get back to it. All we hear is Radio Gaga, Radio Gaga, Radio Gaga. We've been missing when we grow tired.
let's have a party. It ain't no time for sleeping, baby. Soon it's round your street, I'm creeping. I'm better than ready. To trust in one another, right?
Thank you. Since the release of the works in 1984, you've been relatively quiet.
Yes, in a way. We did some touring last year. We did a big festival in Brazil, a Rock in Rio festival in January last year. And then later on in the year, we went on and we did a concert in Auckland, New Zealand, and some in Australia and some in Japan.
It's strange, actually. I think we added it up. And we added, between four or five concerts last year. We played to almost 1 million people, which is, but you know, it's only a week's work. You know, it seems a very sort of efficient way of doing things, but...
You got involved in the movie Highlander.
Yes.
I've been alive for 4.5 centuries. I am immortal.
We initially said no because we just didn't want to be... we wanted a rest, to be honest. And then we saw about 20 minutes cut of this Highlander film and thought, great, that's us.
Now, we had the scripts and we went to see quite a lot of the footage that they got already. And then we all went away and all tried to write songs for various bits.
What actually moved me was the sort of subplot. The main plot is kind of violent tale of immortals fighting each other to the death up to from 15th century Scotland up to 20th century New York. That's the main plot. There's a kind of subplot which is a tragic love story, and it comes about because the hero cannot die, but nevertheless he falls in love with people who can die. So he falls in love with this girl in the Highlands, and she gradually grows old and dies in his arms, and he has to say goodbye to her, and he has to go on. It's a strange kind of tragedy. And that really came across to me very strongly, and I related it to my own life, I suppose, and everybody's life. I thought, you know, love always does come to an end at some time, you know. And so I had this song immediately in my head, which is called Who Wants to Live Forever.
There's no time.
So I ended up writing another slow ballad in a 6/8 sort of, which is called One Year of Love, and that goes, when he eventually decides to have another relationship with a woman again, because he vowed he never would again because it hurt him so much the first one.
We found plenty of things in the plot to jump off on, you know, and to write songs around.
Are you pleased that the new album, though, is not going to be a complete soundtrack album?
Yes, because I think the idea of a complete soundtrack album puts quite a lot of people off, really. I think they're imagining sort of all sorts of orchestral links which don't really do anything. Just background music, which it isn't at all. It's a fully fledged Queen album.
We did all the music for the film first, and they dubbed it onto the film. Then when we came to do the album, we actually rearranged a lot of the tracks, made them, you know, longer, and, you know, wrote more lyrics and tried to make them into fully fledged songs. So they're, so they stand up in their own right, without necessarily having to be with the film. You know, you could actually hear them on the radio, and they would sound like, you know, songs rather than actually more incidental music.
It's a kind of magic. It's a kind of magic, a kind of magic. One dream, one soul, one prize, one gold, one golden glance.
should be.
We all have our own ideas of how a song should be, because, I mean, a song can be done in so many different ways, depending on who's doing it. But sometimes I just feel that it's not right, and like in case of Roger's track, which is Magic, I mean, he did it in a totally different way, which is quite good, but I just felt that there was another commercial streak, and I just realised that he was going away to LA for about a week, so I just got hold of it, and I just changed it around completely, and when he came back, I said, well, what do you think? And he said, oh, I like it. It was a completely different song, but, you know, something that sometimes you can see something else in other people's songs, and, you know, I don't mind them. They do that to my songs as well. They sort of, we all help each other in a way, but that's what then takes a lot of time. The whole thing was, I mean, it's like a group policy. First of all, the group couldn't agree on one single, because, I mean, it was to do with the film, and it was also to do with the new Queen product. Because what's happened, I think, for the first time in Queen's life, as it were, is that we've actually made a film soundtrack, but we've also made a Queen album. So we had to try and let people know that it's not just a soundtrack, because we've got other songs as well. So it was very hard to try and depict that it's not all one soundtrack, it's not just Queen. We had to try and bring two projects together. And so, I mean, within the members of the band as well, we were fighting as to who liked which song. So we couldn't agree at all. And basically what happened was, in the end, that we decided there should be two singles released simultaneously in different territories. And because the film is out in America first, we wanted to go with Princess, which goes with the film. But over here, we released Magic, because we thought that if we release Princess to go with the film, they're not going to see the film here till about July, and they're not going to know what it means. So sometimes you have to sort of get that diplomacy in and work out things like that. So in America, they've got Princess of the Universe. Over here, it's Magic.
One of the videos for a song called Princes of the Universe, which is about the people, not about us, it's about the people in the film who are immortal. You shot that video using bits of the film, but we sort of integrated the two by using Chris Lambert. And so he sort of, he's in the film, and then he suddenly strolls and he's on stage with us and has a sword fight with Freddie and things, which is a nice way of integrating the film in a little bit. And instead of just cutting bits of film. I find that most actors are frustrated rock and roll stars. I know Chris Lambert is. And John Hurt's told me that loads of times. He's a rocker, really. Yeah. And would love to be a rock and roll star. Oddly, isn't it? Most rock and roll stars want to be actors.
I was wondering if you're going to come back and say that.
I'm really bad at it as well.
To start off with, it was a Queen project as such anyway. But we did only like five tracks to go in the film, and then there's about nine tracks now. Is it nine? Yes, about eight. Yes, about nine tracks. So there's additional tracks which are not in the film. So it is a new Queen album anyway. I don't know what Queen stands for. I think it's four writers that write very different songs. And like, I mean, John's been writing quite a lot now, and he just writes in that one area which he likes, which is almost like a Tamla Motown or the sort of, and I love that because I love to sing on songs like that. So he's very different. I mean, you could never call his songs heavy or anything. I think Queen just write four very different types of songs. Some like Brian writes from the guitar, so we have that element, and then Roger, I think, writes from the drums, or whatever. He sort of crosses over a lot, so we have all kinds of things.
I don't know where our motivation comes from, really. Except I think we're all still trying to use this beast which Queen is as a vehicle to get our own ideas across. And we all write very different kinds of songs, and it's quite a challenge to get them through this kind of machinery and get them out. It's hard to explain, but for instance, for myself, if I write a song which has a particular idea behind it and I can hear it in my head, I've then got to take it to the other three, and they will see it totally differently and want to do it in a different way. And some of their input will be very good and very necessary, and some of it will probably actually destroy the meaning of the song. So you've got to be, there's all this interaction going on all the time. And the motivation, the challenge, is to actually get something across in the right way that moves people.
The question is, like, you've achieved everything, what else is there? But the thing is, I have nothing else to do. I mean, I don't know, you know, I can't become a chef or something, you know, I don't know how to cook. So I have to sort of, and I know I can stop doing that and just live on my money, but I'm not that kind of person. I want to work, because I mean, I get so bored, you know, I'd be so bored. And so I was thinking that I know there'll be a time where I can't run around on stage because it'll be ridiculous, you know. And I know when there comes a time when you have to stop. But music will still be my thing. So I mean, I have to think in terms of what I can do. So maybe I'll go into production, or I'll still write songs, because I mean, you can be quite old and not have, you can be, you might not have the physical fitness to run around on stage, but you can still write songs. So one way or other, the music side is always going to be in my life, you know.
Thank you.
I like to capture a song very quickly so that it's fresh, and then you can work on it afterwards. But I mean, I hate sort of trying to write a song, and if it's not coming, oh come on, let's try this. It either comes quickly, and then you have it, you know, like the basic skeleton, and then I say yes, we have a song, and now then we can start putting in all the clever bits. But if a song's not happening, I normally just say, oh forget it, let's try something else.
Second verse, as it were, you left that gap where I go,
that's
hey,
right.
Hey, hey. Oh, yeah, we have to listen to all that. Really
work.
Yeah, at least we know what we're doing.
But
yeah.
Now let's listen and get up.
Yeah. Fred, I think it's just a nut.
Slower than mine.
You know what I mean?
It's just slow, yeah, but with a click track. You know?
Yeah, no, the click track is a little slower. I think unfortunately,
yeah.
Just a touch faster because I'm going to hold back.
Freddie was on the phone and he wanted to go back in the studio and do some more recording. So in the end we went back in the studio and we actually recorded another single. It was his idea really that we should go in and actually write a song together. In fact, I was late getting to the recording sessions because I was actually on holiday at the time. But, you know, it's credited as a Queen composition. But I would, to be honest, I would say it was mainly, you know, Roger, Brian and Freddie that did most of the writing for it.
Actually were about Martin Luther King, and now I don't know, I haven't got a clue what it's about.
Somebody said it was about Bob Geldof, but I don't think it is. No.
So you don't know what it's about, but it's
no, not anymore.
Riveting.
Well, they changed all my own words.
Who did?
Well, that rotter, Freddy.
Make it ring more.
I'm changing it.
That's better.
All right, okay, done. So, no hi-hat, though.
Yeah, take the other drums out. Let just hear it, okay? Let's hear that back.
Sometimes I think videos, I mean, people take them too seriously. Like, I mean, if I write a song and put it on a video, I don't want to sort of create a very, 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 very specific image. Because, I mean, you ruin people's fantasy thing. Like, I mean, every time somebody hears a song, it's you build up your own image of what it's like. And sometimes the best thing to do with the video is to keep it very open. Bizarre. Then that way, a person who's listening to it suddenly doesn't say, "Oh my God, he's destroyed the image that I wanted his song to be."
Okay, fine.
That was almost there. Try another one, okay? Boom. Da da. No. Why don't you just concentrate on the first one, really? Yeah, make you know the two snares, make sure they're even weight, not just da da. It should be da ba.
Got it!
Yes, that's nice.
Right.
It's fun. Ooh, I think it's fun.
You like that?
Well, come in and listen.
Okay.
But then, are you getting the? Anyway, when well. I think for this, if you're going to use it, it has a cymbal smash. Because they're too. To come. The jungle rhythm should come out of cymbal smash, you know?
Okay.
One soul, one God, religion. Whoa, 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 whoa. Okay, it's the wrong part, so drop me in for the first.
Yeah.
Religion, one man, one soul, one God, religion. Oh, whoa, whoa. Right, let's do the second part now. So, one God, religion. Oh, 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 oh.
for the other part?
Yeah.
Which track are we going now? The first track?
Yes, do the first track first.
One God, one religion. One man, one soul, one God, religion. One man, one soul, one God, religion.
Well, because he's very perfectionist and always wants to do things in a big way. You know, he doesn't want to do anything sort of that would be considered, you know, small time or, you know. So, whereas to some of us, you know, the ideas seem a bit grandiose or over the top or, you know, we sometimes have to argue about these things, really.
God works in mysterious ways. And hey, people! Around the world, I look forward to those glorious days once again.
And one goddamn something decision is good, isn't it? Hard.
Not hard. So one goddamn, I think I would like to do that. One goddamn hard.
It doesn't fit. Does one goddamn? One goddamn decision.
It actually sounded like you did it once. One goddamn decision.
Real decision, maybe.
No, it won't fit. She goes, da, one God decision.
One man, one God, one true religion. One voice, one goal, one last decision. Whoa, 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 yeah!
Because Moses is going to sing it on his own, isn't he?
I thought
it
was...
No, let's not make it too blocky. No, but there's no fucking song left for me to sing. If we make these harmonies, then we got another two-part harmony coming in, and then whoa, I haven't got anything to sing. Might as well just be fucking fucking Andrew Sisters.
Whoa, whoa, yeah. Whoa, whoa, yeah. Give it to me.
Yeah, but it doesn't fit. That's why I couldn't sing one religion either. The way I could only sing it, it was one man, one God, one man, one soul, one God, religion. You see, I just put that in, it didn't make sense. Because otherwise I can't go on to the on. I don't want to over.
That's easy, they just take it right out.
It must be that.
One path, one road, one king, one politician.
And it's very nice as well to do that. It's risky.
So it goes bum 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 bum.
Yeah.
Right. How about this?
No, but it's like it could get.
How about this?
Just for for an example, if it was so. One God, one soul, make one decision. You know, that you made the three things at the end, the line at the end as one sentence as well. Make one decision. Or make one true religion. That's good, that's good.
Give me hope. Give me realism. Yeah. Cut it out.
It still doesn't scan. No, sing it. Okay, sing it.
One true vision.
You missed out one whole bit. Of course it fits like that.
Right,
it's like an edit.
Just one true vision.
Just one true vision.
Sorry, you know, because he stopped and he was still looking for the next word. I'm going, is that it?
It was a complete edit.
Well, you just put in one word there, just
one man, one dump, one true religion, one dump, one turn, two tits, John Deacon. Yeah. Chicken feed, babe. One heart, one soul, one sex position. One shrimp, one front, one clam, one chicken.
Sorry, censored.
Vision.
Thank you. Hold on to We have one more song for you. This is
most of our videos tend to be extravagant in budget alone, if nothing else.
Adventure seeker on an empty street, just an alley creeper, light on his feet. A young fighter screaming with no time for doubt. With the pain and anger, can't see a way out. It ain't much I'm asking. I heard him say, gotta find me a future, move out of my way. I want it all, I want it all.
music.
Lunch, everybody.
Sorry to be a bore about keeping you in.
Nice.
You happy?
Okay. Stand by then.
Do we need to lose all the lights?
No. It'll be better with the smoke now. That's it. Right. Everybody face the front.
Eyes forward, please.
See that to me is more. Have a look.
Okay, you better watch the eyes because it's impossible to keep the eyes forward. Open.
Yeah. It doesn't matter if it just says it. Look up front. Roger, look ahead. You're looking to your right, I think, aren't you?
Yeah.
No, thank you, Tom. No, you're not. Sorry. It's me. Tony, when you're happy.
You're looking away from us.
Yeah, Roger, I keep thinking you're looking... Oh, I know why, Roger. Move your body anti-clockwise a bit, Roger.
Anti-clockwise?
That one, yeah.
There you go, there you go.
That's what's wrong. It's got to be right before we go, Tony. Only you know. Brian, a team to step forward.
Hey. Thank God. Okay. Eddie, I want you looking in quickly for this focus. I want Freddie in focus. I want everybody in focus.
Stand by.
Okay, Dave.
That's great. Ready? Turn. Yeah. Music.
Here we go. Turn over and playback. Stand by to go again.
Yeah, it still looks like you're out there. Roger, it still looks like you're looking away from us compared to everybody else.
We're moving the tower over there. So, do you want to say
number one, Bob, and work with Price now, will you? I don't care if you go up earlier and harder. You know, the name of the game is not to look like we're giving Freddie a haircut this time, it's just to get up and over to Roger. Music.
No. Play back.
I want it all. I want it all. I want it all. And I want it now.
That's got to be it. I'm sorry, but that is it.
Final Studios, 35th video.
Personally, I was thinking of not giving away the set until the first scandal. You only have this red behind, and you don't really see what this is. And it is a very very dynamic crane move, which creates a lot of you actually your silhouette and
on. So we're in position already.
Yes.
All right.
I would suggest.
Okay.
I mean,
think
of the way you have to sort of until anybody gets into a position. I mean, I don't think it might look.
Wait, this is it. I won't be able to deliver the song in that because it's like a
mask.
Yeah. And it's not right for this song.
Okay, so the starting lineup is here in front of the office candle for.
Yeah, or whatever. Okay, right, I'll put my makeup on.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, okay. The thing is whether you do a few, I would like to give you a few lines before, and you should sort of work out in what tempo you're going there. Yeah, start the playback, please, for just a sound rehearsal. Ian?
Today the headlines, tomorrow hard times, and no one ever really knows the truth from the lies. And in the end, the story deeper must hide, deeper and deeper and deeper inside. Scandal.
Following Scandal, we're going to put out The Miracle.
Every drop of rain that falls in Sahara Desert says it all. It's a miracle. All God's creations, great and small, the Golden Gate and the Taj Mahal, that's a miracle.
Prepared for it to be good, but we were still quite shocked and stunned at how good these guys were. The young guys, fantastic. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I was really worried in case he sort of thought, oh no, this isn't me. And I mean, it was on the second day when the group came in, and everyone was saying, "Quick, Queen are here," and I thought, oh wow, this is my big time. And like when he walked in, I mean, I thought, this is the guy I'm, you know, meant to be. And like, I just try to watch him all the time, see how he'd behave off stage as well, because that gives you an idea how to work on stage. And I just thought it was amazing meeting him.
The one thing we're all waiting for is peace on earth. And an end to war. It's a miracle we need.
I think it was Freddie's idea to send them out on tour instead of us.
Today.
The end of the day, and it was the first time we could run through the whole thing in front of everyone there. And like, I mean, before we went on, we all said to each other, come on, let's make this good and let's let them see how we can do it. And I mean, having them watching us made us work twice as hard, so you know, we tried to imitate them as best we could.
The one thing
the stuff I do, it's pretending, it's like acting, you know? So you go on stage and I pretend to be a macho man and all that, and then in my videos, you know, you go through all the different characters and then you're pretending anyway.
I think our music is quite visual. It does lend itself to visual things. It's sort of quite big. It's sort of wide screen, cinema scope.
I'm the invisible, 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 invisible man.
John? You enjoying yourself?
I thought you were going to get me. Yes. It's a little hard on the feet after a while, that's the only thing.
It's beautiful weather, and it's horrible wearing makeup in beautiful weather like this.
Yeah.
But it's going very well. It's not the kind of thing you do every day.
I think it was Roger, actually, because at one point, I think he was listening to the song, you know, it had this suggestion of like an express train. And then I think Freddie and I came up with the idea of having a train and calling it the Miracle Express. And it just went from there. So we said, you know, they looked into the possibility of doing it, and it was possible, so we had to go.
If I could make you smile.
But we must have it.
Yeah. We just do it once more.
You faggot.
Just get more and more look.
One, two. Oh, I was supposed to wear my bloody shades for that as well.
Do we do the same thing after the solo on top of us? Should you be with you?
I think we should just do
you're
that.
On the train.
I want you to do both, and then you can pick one. The other one has to do
I've been trying to pick you up, but nobody
has
done
it.
As an invitation, yes.
Just so that you
we'll have a
pick
choice.
The best one.
Shooting yesterday, and you're going to be shooting again tomorrow.
Well, we're just doing some pickup shots tomorrow with Debbie, but this is the end of the train shooting.
So far, you're on schedule.
No, we're about 2 hours late, but it's going very well, and the weather will hold. We'll get a late shoot tonight now.
Not the tunnel! Anything but the tunnel!
Yeah, okay, something like that. One, two, three, four, break through!
Sorry, that's ridiculous.